Hey guys, welcome back. So in the previous video, we were doing the prep work for our project. So we created all the blueprints that we'll need. We imported some audio assets. We also did quite a bit of work inside of our player controller blueprint and set up all the variables and functions and custom events that we will need later on. In this video, we're gonna have a little bit of fun. We're gonna create our checkpoint blueprint, and we're gonna be able to populate that in our level. And by the end of this video, I'll be able to test and make sure that our checkpoint blueprint is working. So let's go ahead and continue. We're gonna start inside the content browser on the checkpoint blueprint. So go ahead and double click, open that up. And we're gonna need to add some components to it. We are now inside the blueprint editor. We're gonna need to add some components. So we're gonna hop up to the very top in the upper left up here. We're gonna add some components. So let's click the add component button. And first thing that we're gonna add is a scene component. Just so that we can rename it and get rid of this little white ball in the center there. So let's add a scene component. Let's call it the root component, like so. And we're going to left click and drag and drop that on top of the default scene root and make it our new root component. Now we can attach other components to this and move them around in the world independently, etc. So let's continue. We have a couple more components that we're going to add. So let's click the add component button again. And we're gonna add an arrow component. So let's search for arrow and add an arrow component, like so. And we can leave this named as arrow, I think that's fine. We're actually gonna use this to determine which way the player should pass through our checkpoints. So we're gonna use this to help us kind of define the manner in which the player has to pass through our checkpoints. So let's add another component, and we're gonna add a box collision component. So it's right there, box collision. And this is going to be our trigger volume, essentially. So long as the player's vehicle passed through this volume and is going in the right direction, etc., then we'll signal that the player has cleared the checkpoint. So in the components window, let's actually rename this. I'm going to hit F2 and rename this to trigger, so it's a little bit clearer on what it is. And then the last component that we need to add is a particle system. And this is going to be the visual indication of where the player needs to go to clear the checkpoint. And I'm just going to leave that named as particle system. I think that's fine. Now, there's a couple of settings that we need to change on our collision, our box collision, our trigger here. So I'm going to hop down to the details panel. First thing we need to do is actually scale it up a little bit because it's very small right now. So down in the details panel with the trigger selected, let's scroll down to the scale section. We're going to change the Y axis. We're going to change this to, say, 6.5. It's going to stretch it out along the Y. And then we also need to bump it up along the Z. So we're going to set this to 6.5 as well. And that should be enough for our player to actually pass through it with their vehicle. So now that we have that, let's scroll down a little bit more. We're going to go to the rendering section for our trigger here. And under the hidden in-game section, which is currently checked, which means that this volume is not displayed in game. We're going to uncheck this for now so that we can test and see our trigger volume in our level. So we uncheck that. Last setting that we need to change down in the collision section, we're going to change the collision presets. Currently it's set to overlap all dynamic. We're going to click this drop down and we're going to change this to overlap only pawn. So only pawns or characters can trigger successful overlap. For instance, if you expanded upon the system and you had some kind of explosions or something that gets spawned in the world, etc., if they happen to pass through our trigger volume, that would actually clear the checkpoint, which we probably don't want. We only want pawns or characters to trigger a successful clearance. So with that, let's actually compile. Let's save. And I'm going to hop over to the level editor here really quickly. And I'm going to fly around a little bit, and we're going to take our checkpoint, just left click, and drag that into our level. So I'm going to place the first one on the track somewhere around there, somewhere after this first little hump here. And as you can see, we have our arrow indicating the direction we want to travel. So for us, since our car is facing in this direction, we're going to go around the track in this direction. And we can kind of manipulate our trigger on the track like so. So we got plenty of room to make sure that the player can enter it. So let's actually hop back to our checkpoint now that it is in the level. And we actually need to provide the scripted functionality for what happens when the player overlaps the trigger volume now. So to do that, we're going to hop to the event graph. So we're going to go to the event graph now. And inside the event graph, we are going to kill all of these nodes here that come by default. We're not going to be using any of these. We're going to create our own network here. So I'm going to select all of those and hit delete. And before we start working in the graph, though, actually, we're going to need to create some variables. We're actually just one variable. So let's quickly do that. You should know exactly where the variables button is after the previous video. So let's add a variable. And we're going to call this variable the checkpoint number. Now we're going to use this to determine and queue up what the next checkpoint should be once we clear this particular checkpoint. So this blueprint that we drive through right now, using this checkpoint number, we'll pass this along to our tracker, which we'll set up in the next video, and that will queue up the next checkpoint that should be spawned in. So we're going to change the variable type, though. We're going to change the variable type to an integer, like so. And we're also going to make it editable, like so. Okay, with that, let's hop down to the event dispatchers. We're going to add an event dispatcher. So go ahead and click the plus sign here. And we're going to call this the checkpoint cleared. So checkpoint cleared. And we're going to use this event dispatcher, as the name suggests here, to let other blueprints know that we have indeed cleared this checkpoint. So we need to add one input to this. So click the new button here, down in the details panel. And this input is going to be called next checkpoint. So when we clear our checkpoint, we'll pass through what the next checkpoint should be. So we need to change this to an integer too as well. So let's make this an integer, like so. And we are done inside the My Blueprint panel. We can begin working on the actual event graph now. So what we need to do, first of all, is grab our trigger in the components window up here. Just left click on it and then right click on it. And at the very top, there's options for adding events. And what we want to add is an on component overlap. There's two options here. There's begin overlap and there's end overlap. We're actually going to use the end overlap. So when the player has touched our trigger and has stopped touching our trigger, that will signify that the checkpoint has been cleared. So we're going to use an end overlap here. And that will add a new node to our graph. And once we have determined that the player has end overlapping our trigger volume, we need to run a check. We need to run a check to make sure that the player has successfully passed through our checkpoint in the correct direction. So to do that, first of all, we need to make sure that it is the player character that has ended overlapping the trigger volume. So to do that, we're going to drag off the other actor pin here, and we're just going to cast to the vehicle blueprint here. So cast to vehicle blueprint, which is our blueprint that we are using for our player character. So I'm going to select that. And if it is not our player character, the cast failed will get called and nothing will happen. But if it is our vehicle blueprint, then we're going to run a check. We're going to use a branch node for this. So I'm going to hold down the B key on my keyboard with B held down and left click to create a branch and connect the executable out to the in on the branch. Now it's asking for the condition, and it's going to give us a true or false. If false, we're not going to do anything if our condition isn't met. If true, we're going to clear our checkpoint. But we need to define what the condition is. So how can we determine that the player is moving in the direction of the arrow and has successfully cleared our checkpoint? Well, because we've added our arrow, we're actually going to use that to our advantage here. So I'm going to select our arrow in the components window up here. I'm going to left click and drag that into the graph. And what we can do now is left click and drag off of our arrow, and we can actually search for get world rotation. So get the rotation of our arrow. Which direction is it facing? So get world rotation. Now at this point, you may be inclined to off of our vehicle blueprint here. So get the vehicle. This is our vehicle here. If we drag off of this, you may be inclined to say get actor rotation. So if the rotation of our vehicle is the same rotation of our arrow component, then we are facing the same direction. You may be inclined to do that. However, you could run into the situation, as I mentioned before in the opening video, where we are moving towards our checkpoint, we go off a jump, and somehow when we land, we flip, and we are no longer facing the same direction as our arrow, but we are moving in this direction towards our checkpoint. So if we were facing backwards and passed through our checkpoint, using these two values here to determine if we are facing the right direction. Obviously, we are not facing the right direction, so we would not clear the checkpoint. That's not essentially the desired effect that we want. So what we can do instead is get the velocity of our vehicle, get our momentum, which way are we moving, and use that as our driving force. So we're actually going to delete this get actor rotation, and off of this as vehicle blueprint here, let's get velocity. Now we have the velocity, so we know which way we are moving. We have the world rotation of our arrow. In order to actually determine if we are moving in the direction when we cross our trigger here, we're going to use a dot product for this. And what we want to do is take the world space rotation of our arrow component and the world space velocity vector of our vehicle. And with that dot product, if it's positive, then we're moving towards the ring. If it's negative, then we are moving away from the ring. So that's how we're going to determine if we are moving towards the ring, regardless of our rotation of our vehicle. As long as we're moving towards our ring and we end overlap it as we are moving towards it, then we'll call that a cleared checkpoint. So to do that, let's drag off of our get world rotation here. We're going to say get rotation x vector. It's going to give us a vector. Now we have the two vectors to use in the dot product. I'm just going to drag off the rotation x vector here and say dot product, like so. And I'm actually going to hold control and just drag this one down to the bottom, like so. And connect this one in, like so. It's going to give us a float value return. So let me move these over just a little bit. Something like this. And for this float value, all we have to do is drag off this and do a greater than symbol. So float greater than float. And if it's greater than zero, that means it's positive. We are moving in the right direction. If it's negative, we are moving in the wrong direction. So that's our condition. You can connect it up like so. And we can continue with the true aspect. For the false, we're not going to do anything. So for the true aspect, all we're going to do is right click, and we're going to call the checkpoint cleared. So search for call. We're going to call our event dispatcher. So we're going to connect that to the true, like so. Target is ourself. And then we have the next checkpoint, which we specified as an input. We're going to take our checkpoint number here in the My Blueprint panel, just left click and drag and drop that on top of the next checkpoint, like so. And the last bit of business we have to do before we wrap this up, the script is very short. We're almost done with this video here. All we're going to do is take our trigger, left click, and drag it into the graph. We're also going to take our particle system, left click, and drag it into the graph. We want to get a reference to both of these components because once we clear our checkpoint, we want to hide our trigger volume, and we want to eventually, when we set it up, hide our particle system. So we're going to drag off the trigger volume here. We're going to say set hidden in game, that same value that we unchecked a moment ago to display it in game. So now we're going to set it to hidden in game. So the new value is going to be hidden. So we're also going to do that for our particle system, even though we don't have it set up just yet, but we'll get the framework in place here. And the last thing that we need to do, we'll drag off of our trigger again, and we're going to say set generate overlap events. So right now we're going to set the value of the generate overlap event. So if I click on this, I'm going to move it up here and connect it to our chain like so. And we're going to leave this unchecked. So we are essentially saying that this trigger can no longer generate overlap events because we're going to turn this on through script when we spawn the next checkpoint. So each time we spawn a checkpoint, we will set generate overlap events to true, and we will set it unhidden so that you can see it. So right now our script is done. That's all we need to do for our checkpoint. So let's drag a selection box around all of this and hit C to create a comment and say, this is the checkpoint system cleared when overlapping ends, something like that. So let's compile and save, and let's actually test this inside of our level here. So let's see, there's our checkpoint. Let's play. And we can see our collision there. So as I drive through it, automatically it should work because I'm facing in the right direction. So if I turn around now, it is gone. We no longer see it, which is what we want. Let's play again. Let's actually try to drive from the opposite side now. So coming in on this side, I shouldn't be able to trigger it from this way because we are not facing or not moving in the direction of our checkpoint. So you can see it's still up. However, let's move in the direction of our checkpoint, but let's actually move backwards through it. So I'm going backwards and I flip and I come and I end up going through it sideways and backwards. I was moving in the direction of my checkpoint when I entered and exited, so we have successfully cleared it. So that is really it. We're about 15 minutes in. This is going to be a shorter video than the previous one. Our checkpoint blueprint is set up. We've set up the script for it. We've added the components. We've tested it out. It works. So that's going to do it for this video. In the next video, we are actually going to start setting up the tracker, so the checkpoint tracker that keeps track of all of our checkpoints, and getting that system in place so that we can start populating our level with additional checkpoints and testing the full functionality out. So that's going to do it. Thank you guys for watching. We'll see you in the next video.